need. So I really welcome this motion, Councillor Thomas, who has, you know, for many years bang on about it, and I'm glad that someone's listening and that we'll vote unanimously on this motion. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Lyons.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Again, we'll also be supporting this motion as we believe that, you know, disabled people and people with impaired mobility are entitled to go wherever they want to go. We welcome the fact that the motion calls on looking at licensing gambling to look at licensing premises. So, you know, why should disabled people not go to you know, wine bars, coffee shops, these kind of places, restaurants. You know, in Adams Cross and Walton, I do get residents getting in touch with me where the premises have been set up, opened, and then they find that they can't get their elderly relative or their disabled child into the premises, and they're very disappointed that a lift has not been installed. So I truly welcome the motion. I do think that, you know, the Equality Act of 2010 has been very, very slow, so hopefully this motion will create impetus and look at how, you know, as a city, we try and move towards equality in this department.
Councillor Miller.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Wonderful motion. One of the things I would suggest, though, is making one small step, as one licensed restaurant has done in Castle Street, to allow direct access, accessible access, through another door is not enough. So there is actually one step that you'd have to go up. So they've opened another door, but if you are in a wheelchair, you have to actually make a fuss and be taken through that door, and that still isn't enough. So they're trying to do something, and there's quite a number trying to do something, but it still alienates some individuals from trying to gain access through a rope that has to be moved, through a table that has to be taken away from the door that you may go in. That's not enough. And I actually think that some of these venues take from a landlord something already built. And actually, we need, from building regulations, from educating our venues, what they should be doing when it's built, or it may be pre-built by somebody else. Well, it's a wonderful venue, let's take it on, there's the right rent, and we'll walk in and there's our new venue. And actually it starts building before that. Delegated decisions, building regulations, there needs to be some changes, and understanding of what is suitable and what isn't suitable. And I actually think maybe somebody needs to pay for a leaflet that could be given to those venues, to those people applying for licenses, about where do you buy these things? Where do you go to? Because there is a lot of ignorance out there when it comes to opening a venue, not just about whether you need to have kind of some accessible materials, whether they're in Braille, or whether you've got the right entrances. Not enough people are educated. And that includes sometimes when we make decisions within this council, where councillors don't get to see it, and it doesn't come to planning, it may be before that. So there's a lot of things that we could do here, but it actually goes right back to the beginning of when these buildings are amended by agents and landlords before the venues get them. But I really do welcome this motion as well.
Thank you, Councillor Mayor Anderson.
Well, I think the motion is a good start. I think the fact that we are the only administration that has a cabinet member with disability is a real plus. But let's be clear about this. The same, the Equalities Act of 2010, it is power enough for us to do what we currently do. I was here the other day with yourself, and you know, we've had to. I had to assist you to get through the building, and there's wedges that open the doors left. Not just because this is an old building, it's not an excuse. We should be aware that people who are attending functions here may need disability facilities, like, for instance, the lift. And got a bit of a leg we can't get through the door, it's always bad money. So we've got to get a little bit smarter ourselves now and do things. What I want to see this as a start, I want to give notice that, we will have a charter mark, and that's fine, but we'll also be coming for it if you don't start making responses to our requests to make equality the top of your agenda, whether it's in planning, whether it's in licensing, whether it's actually supporting people as they adapt the properties to do that. That's exactly what we've got to do. No second-class position for people with disabilities in this city. And that's the message. That's the message that our regeneration team, our planning, our license, and everybody has to clearly say to people. We will name and shame it. That's the message. We will name and shame it, and we will expose it. And we will say it's not fair that you're stopping disabled people coming in here. And we will demonstrate outside, we'll blacklist, do all we need to do. Bottom line is encouragement first, if no one responds, then we have to do a little bit more. And I expect you to lead on that.
Thank you, Mayor. First and foremost, I want to commend these speeches by our councillor, because when you talk about disability or any particular subject, you need to own it. And our sister certainly owns it, and she's got a proven track record of accessibility to campaign for accessibility. And I think, and I need to thank our other members of other parties that will support this. So, you know, it needs to be recognised. The reason why I'm standing up to speak about this, because I didn't choose to, is accessibility and inclusion. And the reason why I use the word inclusion, I have disabilities, and one of my disabilities is I'm dyslexic. And I have a black and white sheet of paper here for a dyslexic person. So, just like Johannesson said, it's about, we go out to organisations to make sure that they're aware of inclusion. But us as a council have to deal with the issues of inclusion, because sometimes we make mistakes ourselves. Hence this. That's all I wanted to say.
Thank you, Councillor. Right, can we move to the vote?
Yes.
Right, those in favour of the motion?
Agreed.
Unanimously agreed. Thank you very much. Right, item 13, customers aside fire and rescue authority. Moved by Councillor Murray. Is Councillor Hanratty seconded by Councillor Murray.
Thanks, Governor. It's a privilege for me to move this motion on behalf of the members of the Fire Authority, because we're all very proud of the work that was done by the officers and the staff. Having said that, I'm going to waive my right to speak in favour of Councillor Peter Carl, who has a statement to read on behalf of Councillor Hanratty, who is actually the chair of the authority, but unfortunately it's too ill to be here tonight. Having said that, I'd just like to make two points to colleagues and members. When we're lobbying government against the cuts, it's really useful if colleagues don't lump together all blue light services, because the individual identity of each service is then lost. For example, since April 2016, we have carried out over 6,000 health and well-being checks in homes across Merseyside as a consequence of the trust that people have for the badge of the Fire Authority. And I think, you know, people are discerning and facing the difference between the police, the ambulance and the fire. And I think if you lump fire in with the police, for example, some of that trust may be lost. And the other point I'd like to make is we have a really modest fire chief. Dan Stevens isn't just the fire chief of Merseyside, he's actually the lead on national resilience.
and he is responsible for the organisation and response to major incidents nationally and internationally. And I think it's worth mentioning, we are lucky to have him, especially when we had an incident like the car park on New Year's Eve. Over to my colleagues now. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Dave has asked me to say a few words in his absence. He wants to be here to speak on behalf of this motion, on behalf of Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority, but due to an observation last Friday, is unable to, but however, he's asking to make a statement to make a help. Lord Mayor, may I first pay tribute to the Chief Fire Officer, Dan Sullivan. Dan, the Deputy Chief Fire Officer, Phil Gavin, and all his team have had the arduous task of overseeing the highest court in the country imposed on Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority by this pernicious Tory government. In 2010, we have seen cuts to the reading of £29 million rising to £87 million by 2020. As highlighted by the Chief earlier, the direct consequences these cuts will have on our local fire service are drastically fewer. Firefighters, fire stations, support and service staff, and less opportunities to carry out community safety and prevention initiatives. These drastic reductions, Lord Mayor, will eventually have an adverse impact on the availability of the ability to respond appropriately to any incident with the appropriate speed and weight of attack, with increases to our response time and limits to the number of firefighters and appliances available to tackle any emergency. Following recent tragic events at Grenfell Towers, the terrorist attacks in London and Manchester, the increased terror threat levels, the demographics and risk profile changes in Liverpool and across Merseyside, as well as seeing an increase in fire accidents and deaths around the country, this government are ignorant to the fact of the increased demands on fire and rescue service. We only had to see for ourselves the catastrophic fire at the Echo Arena car park on New Year's Eve. This incident stretched our resources to such an extent we had to call on mainly fire and rescue services for their assistance. And yet, this government stays silent, but praise our firefighters when it's convenient or politically opportune for them to do so. At the same time as longingly, especially in all our major cities, placing further pressures on their role, because they know our firefighters are a dedicated professional public service in which they rely on when it matters the most. For too long, this government has taken the fire and rescue service for granted, and has even gone as far as saying, abuse this trust and loyalty for their own perverse political ideology, which is what our community is at risk. As chair of Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority, I have constantly argued that the government should undertake a full risk assessment and evaluation of the cuts imposed on the service, but again, the government stays silent. So I would hope, Lord Mayor, that all members understand the importance of this motion and that have an all-party support to send a clear message that enough is enough. Invest in this crucial Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Clark, and please send our best wishes to Councillor Hanratty, who couldn't be here. Councillor Brennan.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I just wanted to just give a snapshot of other work that goes on in Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service over and above putting out fires, saving lives, which is very, very important. But there's other work in the background that the general public don't tend to see, but are also at risk of us having to curtail or actually abolish due to the cuts. And one example is the Prince's Trust that we operate right across Merseyside, which is, it's a 12-week personal development programme for young adults, young people from 16 to 25 years of age. And I can honestly say, being the lead member for the youth engagements at Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service, some of the work that goes on there, it's some of the best youth work and best provision for young people that I've seen in my 45 years of working with young people in this city. So what we see as part of the Prince's Trust is this 12-week, not just a life-changing programme, but a life-saving in some instances, because we're saving some young people from horrendous, absolutely horrendous circumstances. And for the first time in their lives, a lot of them have come to a programme, which is the Prince's Trust, and they've been able to get some hope from it. And I've heard hope used once or twice in the chamber tonight. But in everything that we do at the Prince's Trust, it's all underpinned by quality and diversity. And I'd just like to, if I may indulge a moment, and just a couple of brief case studies of two young adults who did come to the Prince's Trust over the last year. And one was a 19-year-old man, a young man, and he'd fled Aleppo. And on the night of the presentation, after he completed his 12-week course and had learned the rudiments of English language, they put a big screen up on the above us, and he spoke in his broken English, but it was, I don't know, the rack was up there, and he was trying to speak. And he said, "That was my village that I fled, and all it was rubble, absolute rubble." And he didn't know whether his family was still alive. And that young man had zigzagged across 10 countries, and finally ended up in asylum link in Liverpool 7, and ended up in the headquarters of Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service of the Prince's Trust. And that was some journey for a 19-year-old to me. And he had to flee his country because he was seen by the regime that he was colluding with the opposition, because the young man wanted to be educated. He got a place in university back home to study pharmacy. He wanted to be a chemist and help the people in his community, and he had to flee. That young man then came here to Liverpool, and Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service completed this course. And I'm glad to say I have learned recently that he's now back at college here in Liverpool, at the university, got a university place, and he's continuing his studies as a pharmacist. And hopefully one day he may return to his family back home if they're still there. And he's living in a house in Anfield. What I'd like to say also is, there was a young woman also that came on one of the fire and rescue service Prince's Trust. And she was 21 years of age, and she'd had quite a chaotic life. And she comes into the 21 years, what most of us will be able to do in our lifetime. And she was exposed to the drugs and alcohol culture. And she got into a very abusive relationship, and she had a child. When she was on the Prince's Trust, her child was 2 years old, but had been taken from her at 6 months, and was in foster care because of the conditions and the lifestyle of the mother. That young woman, she also completed a 12-week course at the Prince's Trust, and she was advised to do that by a social worker who said it might help you out and it might also assist you at some stage and one day to see your baby daughter again. So she did that, and she proved that she could get up, she could stay free of drugs and alcohol, she could get up in the morning, she was a responsible person. She had a direction in her life, albeit only 12 weeks. But for that 12 weeks, she proved herself. So much so that on the Thursday night of the presentation, she was able to stand up and tell a room packed with friends and all the other relatives of all those that had completed the course on that evening. And she was able to stand up, so tearful, and she broke down, And she said on Sunday, so that was the following Sunday, the course was finished on Thursday, but on Sunday she was going to see her daughter for the first time on supervised access in the last within 18 months. So, and what happened there was because the social workers had seen that this young woman was actually making an effort to turn her life around. How she could have done that if she had been on the Prince's Trust. Which now brings me to another aspect of the Fire and Rescue Service. Again, it's the cadets, Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service cadets program. What we have for me, and we are very, very proud, and Councillor Nicholas accompanied me only recently, and we are the only all young women cadet unit in the country here in Liverpool, and it's at Archbishop Blanche School. And we went out, and I'm sure Councillor Nicholas can back me up. We met the young women on that cadet unit who go out and do lots of community work. And to say that they were so focused in what they wanted to do in their future, helped by the school, helped by the cadets and the staff. And all I need to say, Lord Mayor, is it's not just about putting out fires, cutting your house of the car, it's about the life-saving and life-changing work that goes on. And I must pay tribute, and I'll finish on that, Lord Mayor. And I'd like to thank all the staff from the Chief and Deputy Chief down. But more importantly, who I'd like to thank for helping us and helping us and supporting us in our role on the Fire Authority is Councillor Dave Hanratty. He has been a fair, a professional, a most exemplary chair and leader of the authority. Someone that you can go to at any time, irrespective of political colours. And I know from the support he's given to us on the authority and his leadership, there are others, I would say, in positions of responsibility who could learn a lot from Councillor Hanratty and how he conducts himself there at the Fire Authority. Thank you all.
I would not always be so kind, but I think those stories are worth hearing. Councillor Roberts.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Members in this chamber will know from when I've spoken previously on this topic that I grew up in a house where my dad was a firefighter. So I know from, I was very proud of his experience growing up, of knowing that he was going out, putting out fires, pulling people out of cars, and occasionally saving people's lives. Members will also remember that I came with some pretty strict rules at home. We weren't allowed electric blankets, plug extenders, I told you before, definitely no chip plant. But that was a small price to pay. One thing I haven't told members is that when he joined, his firefighter number was firefighter number 1412. So it disappoints me and it upsets me to know that we're going from a situation where we've had over 1,000 frontline firefighters in Merseyside to a situation where we're predicted by 2020 to have somewhere in the region of 580. Now, I speak to firefighters serving and retired, I speak to FBU members, I speak to fire professionals and fire officers, and not a single one of those fire experts has ever told me that having fewer firefighters will lead to an increase in safety. In fact, I think it's safe to say that it's very much the opposite. Now, I'm the chair of audit on the Fire Authority. So I see the numbers, I see the tens of millions of pounds which have been cut from Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service. Frankly, I think it's appalling. I know that the Fire Authority does everything it can to make sure that we have the most effective service for protecting people's lives across Merseyside. But there's not much we can do when we're having our budget cut by so much. So what I would say to the government is, I urge you, I plead with you, and I beg you, please, 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 fund Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service properly. In fact, fund all fire services properly. And please drop your swinging, free marketeering, rapacious, neoliberal, capitalistic, ideologically driven commitment to austerity. And instead, do what needs to be done for the people of Merseyside, for our communities, so that people can feel safe in their homes and that people's lives are protected.
Councillor Sullivan.
Thanks for having me. Well, I've been on Merseyside Fire Authority for a very, very long time. Under the previous chain of command, I used to be defending the title every week when I was going through. But when I'm lucky to have Chief, and I always address him as Chief out of respect, Chief Dan Stevens and Deputy Chief Phil Gargan. But we're also very lucky to have Dave Hanratty as Chair of the Fire Authority. Historically, when I first went up there, Liverpool Councillors never got a look in with the Chief or then the chain of command. So, you know, it was very much prejudice against us. Under the command of Chief Dan Stevens and Deputy Chief of Cabinet, there's something everyone in this room needs to know. Apart from London, they are forced to retain whole town firefighters. That means there's no retained firefighters like you have in the laser lifeboats. This, in fact, makes the response times a lot quicker if there's an emergency. And hell or high water would detain you never, along with the Chief, to go down that route where we have retained firefighters. USAR, Urban Search and Rescue were called upon from all over the world, just being to Bangladesh, were called upon to go to other parts of the country. I remember one incident where in the middle of Wiltshire somewhere, the firefighters, they actually didn't have any cooking equipment. And a young man on a farm got his foot trapped in a drain and drowned. So things were put into place then when Merseyside Fire and Rescue would go down with a piece of equipment if that happened anywhere else. A kind of incubator to put over somebody with a breathing mask till you actually free from whatever situation they're in. We're also the experts in hazardous materials. We've also got the best industrial relations we've ever had with the firefighters, as I'm the lead member for People and Organisation. The workers are informed, consulted upon, asked their opinion, and not being something that we're all coming in for. They're taken on board, they're listened to. We have our hiccups, but the first time in the history since I was there, we actually have the unions, which I always call for, not to be sitting against the wall, but to be sitting around the table with us. And I applaud the trade unions as well. I haven't really got much more to say on this road there, because if you give me 2 hours, I'll water. But this myth needs to be busted that firefighters are playing pool till the bell goes for them to attend a fire. That is certainly not the case. And years ago, Eddie Klein was on the fire authority with me. And I loved Eddie, even though he was the other side of the floor. But one thing he said, when we're running out, they're running in. And that's something that I'm very proud of. Thank you
all. We're going moving straight to the vote, ladies and gentlemen. Can I see those in favour of the motion?
Agreed.
Agreed. I think that's agreed. Thank you very much indeed. We will